Welcome back to A Beer in Business. I'm Tom Ellsworth, and we are at Dickey's Barbecue this year, a absolute phenomenal organization, and it's my pleasure to be here with Laura Ray Dickey. So on
Thank
a warm,
you.
Almost summer day,
Cheers.
Good to meet you.
Appreciate you having me on.
Oh, I'm really pleased that you're here. And I'm even more pleased because when we talked about doing this, Laura said, let's not do this at the office. Let's do it at one of our Dickey's
Absolutely.
Location because that's where the product meets the public.
That's right.
So tell us a little bit about, I love all this decor and I love this. So tell us a little bit about Dickey's.
Sure. It's really the essence of what we are is right here. It's the barbecue. People come to us for brisket or ribs or chicken or any of our meats, but they come because they really want that authentic pitmaster artisan barbecue. It's in the heart of everything we do. I always say we have very few sacred cows at Dickey's, but one of them is exactly smoking it low and slow on site. It's what we do, it's who we are. Everything else we might evolve or fail, but that will never change. The pitmaster, seeing the pit, being really about the meat and the quality, that's us.
You've got a lot of passion that comes out in your voice talking about the product and talking about the company there.
Well, I appreciate that because that's what it is. We're a passion food. You know, we're not sandwiches, we're not burgers, we're not one of hundreds. We're one of a few, and we really take pride in what we do. I say, you know, we're not rocket surgery, if you will. We're barbecue, so we don't take ourselves too seriously, but we love the food. We love the people. We love what we do. It matters. And I think you can see that. If you walk into a Dickey's, my goal is not only do you smell it right away, you see what's happening, but you feel that passion and you go, okay, I might be able to do this in my backyard, but I'm just as happy coming in and talking to my pitmaster and getting real true Texas barbecue.
You know, you just described your company and you just described the food just so elegantly. How would your people describe you as a CEO and a leader?
Am I around in earshot or not?
No, you're around the corner. They know you can overhear it, but they're being honest from the heart.
I think that they would first and foremost probably say work ethic, and that's probably the ethos of our company more than anything. I am very fortunate to not only be with this brand and in this position, but to work around some of the best people. So it really makes my job easier. I'm asked a lot, well, as a CEO, what do you do? And I really say I'm kind of the chief hall monitor, so I kind of make sure people are where they're supposed to be doing what they're supposed to be doing. And then I'm the chief janitor. I come in to clean things up or just make sure everything is right and in its place. So that's what I do. And I think that would be reflected if someone was to go, you know, hey, what do I really think about Laura? I think they would say she works hard because she expects us to work hard. And so we do everything, roll up our sleeves, whether it's pulling the brisket and doing the fork test or being at the home office and making a marketing decision. We are in it. We have a small group of people. We're not bureaucratic. So we're very passionate. We work hard at what we do, and I hope I reflect that. I think they would say that.
You know, this is an entrepreneurial organization. This was literally a mom and pop that started
Absolutely.
And now is a icon of Texas barbecue.
We hope so.
A platinum icon that's setting the standard that so many people have tried to copy. Hopefully not copy too good. That way you keep your place in the
Touché,
market.
Yes.
People that are CEOs, they don't say, when I was 16 years old, I wanted to be a CEO. Usually, you know, they had a passion. Well, I have a passion for, you know, this, so I hope I'll grow up and be that. Or mm-hmm. I'm really good with numbers, maybe I'll be an accountant.
Sure.
Says, how did you come to be the CEO here? What was that journey like? Because you weren't born here.
No, I was not. I was born in Wheatland, Wyoming, actually. And so there's probably three key things that I think are the reasons that I'm standing here. And first, I was born in Wheatland, Wyoming, and that is not in the pretty part of Wyoming. But you have a career choice of what we call the M's. You're either going to do math, meth, manure or metal, which means you're going to go to work at a metal factory. You are going to go to work on a ranch. My first job was mucking snarls. You're going to be in school, and math is a safe thing to teach in conservative Wyoming, or you're probably not going to make it very far. And so I chose math. I chose the school path, and that meant kind of migrating south, migrating towards Wi-Fi and more people. So that was the first choice that was probably put me on this path to be here, was to choose education, to learn what I could, to always be entrepreneurial, and to work hard. And again, that work ethic really kind of started at the ranch. We got up and mucked stalls. That's what we did before we went to school, when we came home. So working hard is just a passion and a value that was instilled very young for me. So I think that's kind of step one of why I'm here. The second step about why I think I'm here, how I got to where I am from a career standpoint, is right place, right time. I mean, very humbly, I'm just at that age, or was at that age, coming out of school where I had an analog childhood but a digital adulthood, a digital workplace. So I was young enough to be new and to have all of the bravado in the world and not be worried about what I didn't know, but to be young enough to adapt. And so I had some great early mentors. I think very specifically about Rita Wilson at Fairfield Residential or David Niffen at The Point Group. And they were more advanced in their career, but they were looking for someone that had a work ethic, maybe obtusely self-confident, but young enough that could be moldable into being digital and technology savvy. So right place, right time. Good folks, good mentors, taking advantage of the marketplace to go the internet, it's a new thing. They weren't sure about it, but they knew it would be relevant. So I had the opportunity to come out of school and work at that intersection of marketing and technology and just took advantage of being able to work hard, stay late, learn the night before what the clients wanted to know the next day, candidly. But it was in that right place, and it was just self-education and really hard work and reading all the time. And then the third reason I'm probably here is I married Roland Dickey Jr. and had my own career path all set out, and the recession of 2008 hit. And he was rocking along, great CEO, absolutely somebody that I respect in business very much. And I get the question, did you meet Roland at Dickey's? No, I met Roland, and then he drafted me into service after we were married. And smart on his part, he is a smart man. But we hit the recession of 2008, and they were doing so well as a company, but I had that kind of unique background of marketing and technology. And when you're in a recession, you don't have the marketing fund. You don't have the sales. You have to do more with less. And technology and the internet and community marketing and good old fashioned rolling up your sleeves and knowing how to sell catering to people, because you do that through a handshake, not through a billboard, putting those kind of pieces in place. He said, well, we can't afford anybody else, but your wagon is already hitched. So why don't you come on and let's see if we can do this together. And so really went from there.
You know, that's a staple of entrepreneurship where you have to do more with less.
Absolutely.
Can you unpack the marketing a little bit more for what you did there during 2008? Because whether that's a recession or you're starting a brand new small business,
very similar.
Doing marketing effectively with this is all we got. You know, you can't go to the bank, get a loan. You know, either it's a recession or I'm not big enough to get a loan.
Absolutely.
What did you do?
Basics. And it's a good question. So what did we do? We said, what do we have? What can we work with? What's unique? Now, how do we communicate that? How do I go out and build relationships? Or where we were sitting at about 150 restaurants at the time, how do I galvanize 150 different folks to go out and be their own brand ambassadors, which is very similar to being an individual entrepreneur, because they're looking back at the home office going, hey guys, you have all the answers, right? And we're going, sure, of course we do. And what that really means is, yes, we have national branded advertising, and that matters. But it doesn't matter as much when you're in a competitive market, or when you're tight on funds, or when you're in a recession. Again, all very similar to your point of starting up, that you do that on a very personal level. Be the ambassador of your community. Get to know folks. Networking still matters. There are still basics to go in and develop a relationship. Host the chamber. Find ways to be involved in your community. Be the person that they want to do a catering with. Be the person that they want to do a school night with. Be the person that's easy to do business with. And that goes back to that being nice rule. Be nice, be open, be flexible, and work hard. Put the hours in, go meet people. Maybe one out of the 10 people that we dropped a big yellow cup off that day with a menu mattered, but that one big yellow cup can turn into a $500 catering, and that can really cover all of your, you know, your nut for the next day, and that matters. Very straightforward.
That is fantastic. You know, people who have an entrepreneurial mindset, it's not like, oh, well, the company is built now, and so you never leave your entrepreneurial mindset. That mindset is still part of your problem-solving fingerprint. What are you doing right now with Dickey's, keeping that entrepreneurial mindset so that the expansion and growth from a couple stores to then catering to all the things that happen over the life of it, now that there's a next chapter that keeps driving the enterprise forward? And you have to think like an entrepreneur.
Always.
What are you doing?
I think that anybody that's really going to be successful in business, to your point, never loses that. What's my next challenge? What's the next problem I'm going to solve? I think an entrepreneur is really, you know, really in spirit, someone that says, how can I do this better? They're never quite satisfied. So that's a driving force for me, for the company. How can we do what we're doing better? And what's our next challenge? So a couple of the things that we're doing are very technology oriented. We absolutely develop most of our technology in-house. We do that so that we are not dependent on third-party vendors. We have some good vendor partners, providers, absolutely. Mm-hmm. But we came to a place where we don't want to change our business model. You know, certainly there are things about our restaurant and the restaurant industry that are standardized, but there are a lot of things that are unique to us. Coming in, smoking meat 14 hours a day, overnight, coming in at 8 a.m. and having to pull the proteins from the pit, having to manage high food cost items, but still make margin. So there are things that are unique to us that we needed our technology to meet the needs instead of ask our owner operators to change our business practices. Because let's face it, we're 77 years old. We're kind of set in some of our ways. So it was much easier to develop technology to meet those needs than to ask the restaurateurs that have largely joined the brand and the business because they didn't want to be in an office. They don't want to spend hours doing those sorts of things. They want to be with the guests. They want to be with the food. They really want to do that passion part, which is absolutely the great part of the business. So we needed technology to make that easier. So that's one of the things that we're pursuing to stay nimble, to stay relevant. We have to play in the online ordering space. We're third generation now, and so I'm absolutely sure that the original location that's still open and operating on Knox Henderson in Dallas, they had no idea going from kind of a barbecue stand, and they literally called it a stand because it was too small to sit, and they were selling meat, and they were selling ham, and they were selling milk and beer. Not Shiner Bock, but beer. And I know looking forward that they didn't think, oh my gosh, at some point in the future, we're going to be as large as we are, but we're going to be delivering. We're going to be ordering online. We're going to have an app and do that. And that's where the business is because that's where our guests are and that's where we need to be. So that's definitely kept us young and flexible, is to meet the challenge of where are our guests? And that's a kind of a good entrepreneurial question, I think, in any business, but very relevant to us is, where are your guests? Meet them where they are. Make it easy to do business with you. So how can I take on that challenge instead of expecting our guests to do that?
That is so phenomenal. There are nuggets throughout that answer that I can apply, whether I'm running a t-shirt company in Berlin, Germany, or a jelly company in Belarus, or a home builder in Omaha, Nebraska, all of which are people that talk to us about beer and business and say, hey, I just learned something. You know, you're talking about developing the company and keeping it nimble. Mm-hmm. You also mentioned books. So it sounds like you also have a path of self-development and keeping yourself fresh.
Absolutely. And that is something that, you know, I say our culture is, we have a very small rule book because we're fortunate to have a very strong culture. So we tend to attract like folks. We're not for everybody. We absolutely are a bunch of type A people that get up and are passionate about what we do. We absolutely have a work ethic in common, but the other thing that we have, and I seek out in people, because it's a characteristic I want to develop in myself, and that's having a curious mind. Completely voluntarily, our culture is we have a book that we read every month collectively. You don't have to. It's purely for personal enrichment, but it's always a business-oriented book so that we can have that language of business, that conversation, and take different pieces of wisdom from all over. One of my favorites, that actually Paula Suarez that works with me, she's worked with me for almost 8 years now on the tech development side, and it's a great book, and it is the Power of One, and it is such a good book, and it is all about personal accountability. It is all about responsibility. It's a great thin little book, but I would highly recommend it. We also read all of Jim Collins. We're very much good to great, built to last. Absolute devotees there. Love Malcolm Gladwell. I love The Tipping Point. I think there's a lot of wisdom there. But we run through books and we invite the other team members to submit books for that.
You know, it's interesting you say that because the gentleman I'm in business with, we emphatically believe in reading. Mm-hmm. And we had a very ambitious reading month last month. Mm-hmm. We read Principles by Ray Dalio. All 550 pages of it.
It's impressive.
But we got everybody through it. And the reason is because the two things you just mentioned, have a curious mind and be committed to personal development.
Yes.
And you can develop in your job, but your job develops you as the company evolves with you.
Yes.
Company's going bigger, then you get this kind of development. You get challenged usually by volume. Oh, you've got this department, you had this many transactions last month. This month you have to do this many transactions. So you get drawn into development usually by growth and volume. You don't get drawn into development by new ideas, because you're usually chasing what's going on, hoping it doesn't fall over. And so we've gone through that, and I think it's a wonderful testimony to leadership. And so I toast you on the reading part.
Thank you.
Keep them reading.
Absolutely.
And you don't have to keep it optional. You can say, I'm going to give you an hour a week to read, and I expect you to read.
Sure. And I can. I actually, as a CEO, don't like to use the word expect, because I want to be around folks that are self-motivated, because I expect to be self-motivated. And certainly we have accountability and we set expectations, but folks that are really going to excel, that are really going to push the brand forward, they're going to do it on their own. That's what they're going to do. They're going to pick up the book and go, now what can I read extra? And so I like to see people that will do that for themselves. I think that's important.
So now let's talk a little bit about recovery, because, you know, most people will think about entrepreneurship and say, well, it'd be nice to be like this company or that company.
Sure.
Because they made it and they didn't blow it. And I says, wait, you have no idea. There was probably 2 days in their history where they almost blew the whole thing.
Absolutely.
Can you give us an example of where, you know, you personally encountered a mistake where you said to yourself, Laura Ray, that was the wrong way to do that. Mm-hmm. And then you had to manage, discover, or invent your way out of it, or just confess and move on. Do you have a story you could share like that and what you did?
I have so many, and that's what I always say. It's not my successes that are really valuable, it's the failures. It's what I did wrong that I learned from and got better. And a couple jumped to mind. One, kind of simple but early in my career, and it goes back to having that good mentor, is I was, you know, young and very self-assured, and I was going on my first big business trip, and I was going out to evaluate these properties to see, because we were in housing at the time, multi-unit housing. And I was on my own and I was doing an eval, and I thought, oh, I'm gonna come back and Rita's gonna be so happy with me. I have just picked this apart and done this wonderful eval for the brand on this property about how they're off brand. And I was really proud of myself, and I thought, I have nailed this. I have gotten everything, it's all there. Then I handed it to her and she goes, okay. And she sat it down after she looked it over. And she goes, you know, Laura, I'm gonna tell you that it's okay if you fall down and skin your knee, because that's how I know that you're moving forward. And on this, you've fallen down and skinned your knee. And I'm like, Rita, what did I do? I've done everything you've asked. I've been so thorough and so detailed. And she goes, no, you did what was literally asked, but you missed the point. You missed the objective. I didn't want you to go down and just pick apart what was off on the brand. I wanted you to help them find the solution. I wanted you to make it better. I wanted you to show them the way out. So anybody can point out what's wrong. How did you make it better? And that was one of those moments that really stuck with me, to go, okay, don't just do the literal, but make sure you understand the objective. Make sure you can leave something better. And that was one of those early life lessons that really stuck with me, especially because I was very cocky and thought I had done a very good job, and I had not. And kind of fast forward that into a much more expensive challenge, but very candidly, midway through my career to that point at Dickey's, I had taken on the role in technology and was inheriting that role from another person. And they had a wonderful idea, and I came into a project, so not necessarily one of my own design. But when I got into the project and looked around, and I thought, we've made a big mistake here. We have rolled out an initiative and it's absolutely wonderful on paper, but we didn't do good communication and we didn't do good training. And so I have this wonderful product that is in the hands of all these owner operators that are going, do you know what to do with this? I don't know what to do with this. Okay, we'll just wrap it back up and put it on the shelf. And it was such a lesson of, it doesn't matter how good the technology is. It really doesn't matter how good the idea is. If you can't get somebody's buy-in, and it went back to that Rita lesson, did I communicate? Did I understand? Had we done this right? So we had to re-roll it out at great expense to the company. And I've taken that lesson forward where we're rolling out another technology initiative. And I said, I don't care what the technology costs. We've got to couple that with two people being on site that can make sure the owner-operator understands, has the opportunity to be trained, can ask questions. Because again, that technology doesn't do any of us any good in a box on a shelf. They've got to be engaged in it, understand it, believe in it, have buy-in in it. So definitely valuable lessons there.
You know, I think it's interesting. So you're in technology, and you're a CIO.
I was.
I think it's amazing. I'm a recovering geek, and
I'm still knee-deep myself.
No, I love the magic of software, but there's also the magical way that you can spend a lot of money automating something that didn't need to be automated.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
And while completely missing the point on some things that were just screaming for automation, and that automation didn't have to be complex. It could be a very
yes.
simple system that took 2 minutes per transaction off something, and it was blatheringly simple, and it was, you didn't reinvent, you know, Oracle and the SQL database.
Right, because you didn't need to. And that's one of the things I work with. Part of our development team is in Croatia, so I have the wonderful opportunity, we co-shore. So usually start about 5:30 in the morning and we're on calls going through things. And it's a wonderful challenge and I love them. They're some of the best folks I've had the opportunity to work with. But it is so interesting when they develop something and we talk about it and they're so proud and then they want to come back and go, well, how was the user acceptance? And on the really complicated, interesting things that they're most excited about, I'm like, well, that was good. But here where you automated this and added the print button, everybody went wild. And they're like, and I'm like, that's it. It's not always the sexy part. It's the part that's really valuable, that's usable. And so matching the development kind of wizardry with what's just happening in the back of the house, make it as simple as the pit, and we've done our job as developers.
I reached into a drawer recently, about 3 months ago, cleaning out a drawer that had like my old phone chargers, a couple old mm-hmm. phones. You probably have a drawer like that.
I do.
I thought I got rid of this phone, and now, you know, break it, you know, don't just,
oh no,
don't give
absolutely.
It to, as much as a homeless shelter might need these things for crisis communication, 911, you just can't give up old phones because now we know that
the data
all the,
footprint
all the
that's
stuff
there.
That's in there.
Absolutely.
And what I found in the back of there was my original iPod, and there are four little buttons on the top.
Mm-hmm.
And also in there was my second iPod that had one circular interface. You remember that?
Mm-hmm, I do.
And then there was no interface. And I sat there looking at that and it reminded me, Apple just kept making it simpler. And yet the device was doing so much more. Do you remember the circle?
I do.
It just was, and it was like the most simple
menu. That's so great.
Menu. Mm-hmm. Then you say, wow, the time that went in to make that simple.
Yes.
So it was easy to use. That is the same attitude we should take in a business setting about making it easy for our operators,
absolutely.
Your franchisees,
mm-hmm.
and others. The technology doesn't have to be, you know, you're gonna go to TED and do a speech about how you've automated the toilet.
Exactly, it's the simple. It's one of our three mantras is simple genius. That is true genius, is simplicity. If I can make it simpler, if I can make it easier, if I can make it faster, then it will bear fruit. You will save money or you will reap the reward of time, and that's what good tech development should do. Whether it's in a restaurant or any place, in my opinion, is that simple genius. Then it's the evolve or fail. How do I make it better?
Second mantra, evolve or fail.
Second mantra, evolve or fail. And then the third is how first should second. I think that is such an important business question. Because if you get into the pontificating about should, will this work, why, answer the how question first. How could I make this work? If I'm gonna put all the other questions aside, how would I get there? And then let, once I've decided how that would work, open the conversation to should. But I all the time have, especially folks that are new in their career, will sit whether it's developing an idea for a piece of software or a software extension or some even R&D in the restaurant, and we'll get onto an idea and they'll want to immediately go into how, why should. They'll express their opinion on, well, we'd meet this obstacle. Well, this would be a challenge. Well, why should we really do this? And they get really off on a tangent of why or should. And I say, that's second. First, we're going to get to how. Let's commit to this being something we will do. And once we get the path to how, then we will go back and overlay, is it worth it? Does it work? Is the ROI there? But answer those questions second. How first?
If you had it to do again, what chapter of your career would you have done differently?
Oh my gosh. Well, if I could take the knowledge, I would redo all of them and just do it better, because I would want to, would have that curious mind.
No, you don't have a DeLorean to go back and do the whole thing again.
That's what I would want. To do differently, probably the most recent one, as far as it's the closest, so I know I could do that the better. I think the lens of time has allowed me to be nostalgic probably about what was really hard when I was younger, but I get so much value out of it because I can think back to those people and those times and those lessons, and getting to work with clients and working, one of my favorite people on earth is Jerry Murray. He was my original boss at Murray Brown Creative Group when I was at TCU, and it had such an impact on my life, largely because he had a smaller creative shop, so that meant everybody did three or four things. Yeah. I was the intern, but that also meant that I worked PR and that I worked at events, and you know, if Billy was shorthanded, I went in, did something in Photoshop. So I really got a robust, rounded education, largely because they needed me to. And that has been one of the most valuable experiences of, you can be self-educated, you just have to have the work ethic, the discipline, and find the opportunity. And Jerry really gave that to me. In fact, what's lovely is now where I am in my career and working and evolving the Dickey's brand, I got to reach out to him and say, hey, would you come and work with us on some of our creative? Would you mind helping find a CMO for us? And he's done that, so we get to still work together professionally. And he really set me on my career path, again, largely because I was obtuse enough to not know better. And he was probably budget strapped enough to need the intern to do a lot of things, and it just worked really well.
There's so many things that take time to learn, like developing a little playbook on people. Mm-hmm. You have to hire enough of them and then say goodbye to enough of them, and you develop that muscle for managing people over time. There's other things that if some good-hearted mentor had just told you on day one, you could have done it on day one. What are a couple things that you wish you knew on day one that would be good advice to give to a young entrepreneur?
Sure, be direct. And sometimes people struggle with that, and I'm making a judgment statement here, but especially women, you have this politeness about you. And again, that's not contradicting, be nice. Always be nice, have manners, but be direct. If you don't understand, ask. If you disagree, politely do so, but be direct about it. Don't assume someone understands, and don't make it somebody else's responsibility to interpret what you need or what you're trying to say. Be direct.
How do you, as a leader, approach replication? Because you want to replicate parts of your
systems,
culture,
absolutely.
But you also, you never want to have a unicorn running finance. Because if they have a baby, or mm-hmm. if they have a parent that has cancer, they're going to be on leave.
Absolutely.
And you're going to welcome them back to the family mm-hmm. when all that's over, mm-hmm.
Absolutely.
Hope. But in the meantime now, oh no, the unicorn isn't here. How do you approach replication so that you've now got two horses doing this, because you're going to grow and you're going to need two, and you also want to replicate culture, because it's such a broad and intriguing concept, and I hear a lot of leaders talking about it. How do you approach it?
Sure, and that's such a good question, because I think what's really relevant, especially to entrepreneurs, is that you have replication without too much duplication. So you don't want waste, you don't want bureaucracy, but what you do want is systems and processes. And that is very different than micromanagement. But it is incredibly important to document key systems, document key processes, have that repository of information that whether it's day one or day 100,000, you really kind of know where that central nerve system for the business or the brand is. So I think you have to create that. You have to give everybody access to it. You have to be disciplined and not take for granted your folks, but you have to ask them to make sure that they benchmark their key initiatives. And we've had that. We're very lucky to have Paula, again, one of my right-hand folks, and many women in our office, because we have a large number of women. It's kind of interesting when you think about barbecue, not necessarily the stereotype you make, but we have a lot of female executives, most of which have left to have children and come back. So I love that about the business, but it did bring up that challenge. And Paula specifically, because she worked in, does head now development for software with me. And when she was out, not with just her first, but her second child, we ran into that. And if we hadn't had such good documentation, such good processes for as simple things as meeting recaps, but repositories for trial and error and development, and just notes, whatever system you use to just have good documentation is really important. Also, make sure that folks, like the unicorn problem that you say, are always challenged to invent, but you really have a strong culture of implementation, which is learn how to do this and refine doing it better instead of kind of find a new way without documenting it or sharing it or telling anybody. Because then you may have a unicorn that has invented this wonderful system, and if you haven't shared that, then all of a sudden you can really be at at a critical point and go, I didn't know you were doing that. That's wonderful. But now that you're in a conference in California and we need this, you know, really done now, you can run into those very real tactical challenges. So documentation, communication, kind of an open culture, I think really, really helps with that.
You used a word in there which I love, which is benchmarking.
Yes.
And from the moment I walk into any organization, I always ask, as soon as I'm comfortable around them, because I don't want to ask questions that make people uncomfortable, like a friend's business or things like that, substantial stuff, I always get to, tell me about your dashboards and your benchmarking.
Absolutely.
And when you use the word benchmarking, talk a little bit about, you're never too small to start benchmarking,
Absolutely.
Start printing it dashboards, and coming from where you come from with the CIO background, I suspect you have a strong opinion on this.
I have a very strong opinion on that. And this is one of our first large technology initiatives we did for the brand. So think about coming out of 08, and we had the opportunity to go, what could we have done better? Have access to our data. We had great data, but it was siloed. Marketing had great data, operations had great data, R&D had great data, but they were all spending so much time gathering it and not making it actionable. What's the quickest way to make information, data, communication actionable? A good dashboard, which means you don't have to spend a ton of time finding it. It isn't a hide and seek kind of game. It is visualized. You have a centralized system that you can go and pull up your key performance indicators, all of your key information. All those key careabouts should be no more than two screens away from anybody, and that's a good dashboard. That's what you really want. And then you want a repository system that is simple enough so that you don't have to have very complicated training on becoming, you know, systems user expert. It should be simple. And there's good off-the-shelf software that will do that for you. We built our own from our data warehouse, from our BI platform. But we did that because we have three or four dashboards that we need to use on sales, operations, marketing, and the brand, and training. But good benchmarking, good information, access to information. I mean, that's really the key. And it kind of goes back to that curious mind. You want to empower folks to help themselves. What's the best way to do that? Give them access to the information. Give them a good dashboard. Make it simple. That matters.
The best advice I heard on dashboards was, don't get overwhelmed by some of the big dollar systems. And I'm not gonna name them, but we both know what they are. Mm-hmm. You can do this on a simple spreadsheet.
Yes.
And the simple test is, what things do you need to see in a spreadsheet that can be printed on a single piece of paper that tell you what now?
Yes.
So that you look at something, it's like, this patient's temperature is 101. What now? Well, we have to drop the fever, because 101 is a fever. You need to get the items in front of you that matter to your business,
yes,
that will tell you if something's got a fever or not.
Mm-hmm.
And you can say, what now, what now, what now, what now? And in a stand-up staff meeting, you can take that dashboard
and
five
like this.
People have their mm-hmm. what nows for the day, and now
yes.
you're correcting, improving, mm-hmm. or cutting a problem off at the pass, as we say in Texas.
yes, which we do often. But that's exactly it, because it is not only the what now, which is a perfect way to put that, but it is making that accessible, actionable, so they have that plan, that empowerment, and then you can go back and benchmark the movement. You can benchmark the act. Did I move the needle? Because I think maybe one of the biggest opportunities for waste in business is good work that doesn't marry with good results. Because you can have a lot of folks that will do a lot of good work, but if it doesn't push the results, then you just have a lot of good work. And that doesn't really, at the end of the day, do anything to push your business, push your brand, or do anything you can take to the bank. And that's ultimately why we're here in business. Certainly to do, for us, not only well but good, but the well part is required. You have to make money at what you're doing in order to keep doing it. And so to do that, you gotta have results. And you can't have results if you don't have benchmarking. You know, how would I expect someone, whether it's an owner operator or a team member or a colleague next to me, to be able to get someplace if they didn't know where I needed them to go? And that's what's so important. And then have a way to measure, how far did they get? Did they get those results? Did this matter? Did it get there?
You know, you have given a lot of kernels that have just been phenomenal. And that answer about, you know, dashboards and what you do there is one of them. And it just emphasizes of how much we need to use technology to be effective while we're at work. But there's also this thing about work-life balance. Does it exist? Is it a myth? As a person who is keeping an entrepreneurial spirit here, what is your take on that?
I think that it is, for entrepreneurs, the wrong question to ask, actually.
Really?
And I get that a lot, because people are going, how can you have, you know, a quality of life? How, you know, what's that? Again, just balance in where do you end work? Where do you begin your personal life? And I think it's the wrong question to ask for entrepreneurs, because if you're really going to build a business, you're really going to build a brand, or you're really going to build whatever that passion is for you, it absorbs all of you. And so what's really important is for you to be okay with that truth. And if you're not, that's all right, but it probably means entrepreneurship or maybe a higher level position in a company where so many folks depend on you. That's probably not for you, and that's okay. It doesn't have to be for everybody. But you need to be okay with the commitment that it takes, that there will be unexpected calls, unexpected schedules. Picking the right partner in life, whomever that might be, that will support that is very important. But not that you don't have a personal life, but having the metric in your mind that this is the right balance is just not the right question to probably find success in entrepreneurship. Because it really is about giving all of yourself. You wake up in the middle of the night and you're thinking, what can I do better? Or you're reading a book. You choose the book you read because it would make the business better. Or we'll go on vacations and it's, oh, well, we could go here so that we can stop in this brand that we've really wanted to see. I mean, it never kind of leaves you. And so it's just that reality that to really do this and be successful, you have to give a personal part of yourself. And that's where I go, the work-life balance is a little bit of a myth.
Speaking of work, I know you got to get back to work.
Yes.
We got to get back to work too and building things. But thank you so much for your time today.
I appreciate it.
We have been here with Laura Ray Dickey, CEO of Dickey's Barbecue here in Dallas, Texas. I'm Tom Ellsworth, and I hope we left you better than we found you. And we will see you next time on another chapter of A Beer in Business.